My name is Julia Liuson. My team built some of the most widely used developer tools in the world, products like Visual Studio Code, Visual Studio, and GitHub. So it's very important to me that we must continue to earn and maintain the trust for all of our customers.
And I'm John Lambert, Corporate Vice President and Security Fellow on the Microsoft Threat Intelligence team.
So today, John and I are going to deep dive into Microsoft's Secure Future initiative that we launched last November and further expanded earlier this month. As Satya mentioned in his keynote yesterday, there are six pillars in our security initiative. And today, John and I are going to really focus on two pillars which are particularly relevant to developers. It's the protecting identity and secrets and protect your engineering system. Now, over the years, we have done a lot of work for each one of these pillars. But in response to the evolving threat landscape, we have made security the absolutely top priority. We're very committed to prioritize security above anything else and for all of Microsoft.
Well, developers chart their career milestones by the products that they ship, but security people, our milestones are incidents. So for me, that's SQL Slammer, Stuxnet, SolarWinds. It's just very important that we learn from these incidents. And so SFI has three core principles at the heart of it: secure by design, secure by default, and secure operations. It should be the case that developers don't have to do a ton of work in order to secure what they're doing. We want them to fall into the pit of success, and that starts with these three principles. Now, Julia, you and I have worked together for like a decade, but I feel like in the last 3 months, we've spent more time together than the entire 10 years. And I guess there's just no better way to speed the learnings from incidents to improvement than just to work together every day.
Yeah, and as important as all of the technical work we're going to embrace, security really is a team sport. So it's going to take a culture change for everyone at Microsoft and in the industry. Instilling a security-first culture will be critical for us to engage the entire company and industry in this problem space. We are sharing our learnings today because many of the challenges we face are really not unique to Microsoft. It really affects most of the companies in the industry. Now, John, you have been in the security business for a very long time. And can you share with some of the changing trends that you're seeing and also discuss the evolving threat landscape, which really provide context for the entire security initiative as well as the culture change that we want Microsoft and the industry to drive towards?
Yeah, organizations, they don't face threats, they face threat actors. And boy, they have been busier than ever. At Microsoft, we track over 300 different threat actors from nation state to cybercrime. For them, hacking is their job, and they want to be good at it, but they don't want to have to work harder than they have to. And what's easier than hacking in? Logging in. And so they really focus on password-based attacks, and we've seen over 10 times increase in password-based attacks just in the last year. All of this activity, it creates a kind of anti-economy, estimated to be worth $8 trillion, and if it was a country, it would be number three in terms of GDP. So they want to work really hard, but at Microsoft, we want to make them really, really bad at their jobs.
And talking about these threat actors, one of them you and I have been spending a lot of time in the last few months working on, and it's called Midnight Blizzard. Can you tell us more about this one?
Yeah, so first in our taxonomy of how we name actors, Blizzard is the family name for threat actors originating from Russia, and we spent a lot of time tracking and learning about this actor. As an intelligence agency, they target government departments, defense contractors, but the second most prevalent vertical they target is information technology, stuff that developers make, because hacking that gives them access to all of the rest of their targets. Hackers deeply focus on the idea of hack one to hack many. They exploit chains of trust and transit of access. I've often said that defenders think in lists and attackers think in graphs, and as long as that's true, attackers are going to win. And Midnight Blizzard shows a strong command of thinking in graphs, how systems are connected and how they traverse. And so how do you traverse that graph? Credentials. And one of the things that we've learned from our own incident is that it's very important to treat non-prod to the same security standards as production itself. Midnight Blizzard targeted developers. They targeted developers to get credentials of developers, and they got credentials that gave them access to demo and test systems. They are using those credentials they're getting to build an attack graph. They want to know where those credentials lead.
Yeah, because password is just a string. So developers risk accidentally checking them into their source code or emailing it to a colleague. To help mitigate this risk, we built GitHub Advanced Security with secret scanning. When we work with our customers to turn on secret scanning in GitHub Advanced Security, nearly 100% of the customers found that they have some secrets in their source code. And sometimes they actually discover thousands of secrets in the first scan. Another risk with the scanning tool is that it's not perfect. It may not identify every single secret because it's just text. And some of these secrets don't have very obvious ways to identify them.
The other thing with secrets, in an incident, we also have to rotate them. And that means security people have to page developers, and we really don't like doing that. And developers really don't like getting those pages. And so that's why it's really important that we move to managed identities that are system managed. That allows us to also like rotate them automatically, and then it saves toil, but critically in response, it gives us speed.
Yeah. So we are taking this learning and applying it to our Protect Secret pillar. One of the key actions is that we want to ensure 100% of applications are protected with system managed identities. Now, where we really want to go in the long run is that we want there to be no passwords at all. So developers cannot accidentally leave them in source code or email them, you know, to their friends, and they never have to rotate them ever again.
Yeah, this is going to be challenging because as a developer, like where you go online to learn about how to finish a scenario or watch a video about it, they all tell you use a password to do that.
It's absolutely true. And most cloud providers have videos and samples out there that actually take use of passwords. So this problem is certainly not unique to Microsoft. It's a prevalent issue across the industry. And we are taking great pride in how we build tools to help developers really be very, very productive. So we are actively working on improving our tools with secure by design and secure by default principles. That means we want developers to be able to just follow the guidance set by the tool, and the paved path in the tool will automatically use system-managed identities, so developers don't really have to think about it. Now, we do anticipate that by using system-managed identities, it will feel a bit more complex because there's a little bit more code and concept than just using a simple text-based password. But this is where security-first culture change really needs to happen. We must embrace productivity and simplicity with a security-first mindset. So now, John, this is also not the first time that you have run into Midnight Blizzard, right?
That's right. They were also the threat actor behind the SolarWinds incident. So SolarWinds is a company in Texas that was the victim of an intrusion by Midnight Blizzard. They compromised their build process behind their product. And so when the product was built, malware from Midnight Blizzard inserted a backdoor into the product. Now, that malware, that backdoor, was never checked into their source repo. It was inserted during the build process, so the product would get built, digitally signed, go through update systems to their customers, and if Midnight Blizzard was interested in one of their customers, they followed up with a secondary backdoor. This shows us that the SolarWinds actor, Midnight Blizzard, they're interested in supply chain attacks. They want to be able to infiltrate the software supply chain in order to get access to end customers. It also makes detecting these attacks very difficult. So threat actors, they target code, they target organizations, and they target the engineering systems that make the applications that those organizations use.
So this SolarWinds example really shows the importance of protecting our engineering system, which is a key pillar in our security initiative. You just spoke about what can go wrong when an intruder attacks the build and release environment. Another very important dimension of keeping our engineering system secure is to understand the entire surface area of the engineering system. During our security initiative, we actually deleted over 700,000 unused demo and sample and test applications. And we have also deleted a lot of the repos and build pipelines which are associated with these applications. Now,
yeah, getting rid of like unused apps and systems, it's just really important for security, because threat actors, they just care what's on the attack surface. They don't care if you consider it legacy or modern, or it's something you're managing or not managing. If it's got credentials, and if it's alive, and it's got, you know, access to resources, that's what they want to go after. So sometimes the fastest way to de-risk is to get rid of old systems and applications.
Yeah, exactly. And as we apply the secure operation principle, there are two really important lessons to improve the overall, you know, operating environment. The first one is that get rid of anything you don't need from your overall engineering system. The second one is that we really need to treat non-production samples and test apps just like production app with the same rigor. This is why the build and maintain inventory for 100% of the software asset used to deploy and operate Microsoft product is a key SFI action that we have outlined. We want to make sure all of our applications, no matter if it's a sample or a demo app or production, and all of their repos and build pipelines have clear cycle, you know, have clear lifecycle management and policy governance. John, I think another very interesting topic to discuss is the attacks on the developer ecosystem, particularly the open source ecosystem. We have been seeing some very sophisticated social engineering.
Yeah, attackers have gone from attacking code to customer systems to the developer projects themselves. A recent example is the XZutils backdoor. This is an open source project. It's used by Linux-based systems. XZutils is a data compression library, and it's used by critical things like SSH. And you could understand why a threat actor would want to backdoor SSH. So this threat actor worked for years to cleverly insert a backdoor into this project, just waiting for the moment where it would get wide distribution. They knew security tools would run against it, and so they cleverly concealed it. They were almost there. There was just one glitch. The way they made their backdoor, it gave XZutils just a little bit of a performance slowdown. Not a big one, just a little bit of one. But they kind of met their nemesis. Their nemesis was a developer with a memory profiler. And so at the final hour, a Microsoft engineer, Andreas Freund, he was working and running some regression tests, and he's like, why is this thing slower than it should be? It shouldn't be slower. That didn't change. What's going on here? And he just kept digging and digging and digging, and then he discovered the back door. He saw something, he said something, and the resultant investigation around the world prevented that back door from getting mainstream distribution. So, even though Microsoft wasn't affected by this backdoor, it's just a great example of security culture in action.
Yeah, and I really love this story because it shows the behavior of a developer who has security-first mindset. It's also a great reminder for all of us the importance of securing all of our software supply chain. With each one of these attacks inside Microsoft, we're always looking at whether our existing systems of managing OSS is good enough to actually help us defend against these attacks. We're also building our learnings into GitHub Advanced Security Dependency Review. With Dependabot, it'll help developers to alert whether repo is using a piece of software with vulnerability. It will actually generate PR to help developers mitigate these issues.
Yeah, raising alerts is good, but to get them acted upon quickly, you need the right security culture.
Yeah.
And so part of that is education. Someone once said that training is for certainty, education is for uncertainty. And security is just full of uncertainty. So yes, take your security training, but also embrace curiosity. There's just so much more that we all have to learn.
John, thank you so much for sharing insights on how threat actors actually approach their job. I think that we will all need to embrace the new security-first culture. Security is a team sport, and it's job one for everyone at Microsoft. It's super disturbing to see how many known threat actors are actually out there and how they're actively hacking the entire industry. Defending against threat actors is not only Microsoft's challenge, but also a challenge for every single company. So we will require collaboration of our customers and partners to collectively raise the overall security posture, as we learn more, we will continuously improve our system and tools. We want to also help our customers improve their application code and engineering process as well. As a global provider of software, infrastructure, security, and cloud services, we are committed to do our part to make a world a safer place. So thank you for being here, being part of our security journey. I can't wait to see what you build. Thank you, and enjoy the rest of the build.